The Lord said to him, "Go back the way you came, and go to the desert of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael, king over Aram. Also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, and anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel-Meholah, to succeed you as a prophet. Jehu will put to death any who escape the sword of Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escape the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to Baal, and whose mouths have not kissed him." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We find comfort in God being with us always. So we sing the words of Psalm 73. Separate us from the love of God they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, O Christ.
You may be seated as we sing, "Be still my soul."
Thank you.
waves lapping up against them during the storm to try and get away from the fire and the smoke. We know of devastation. We know of trouble and trial. Maybe we haven't had a fire go through our area, but we have understood trouble and trial on this planet. You and I have all faced all kinds of difficulties, but God comes to you today and says, "Be still, my soul. Be still your soul because of Jesus. Be still your soul because Jesus is on your side. Be still your soul because nothing can separate you from God's love." Let's take that first part today. Be still your soul because God is on my side. Do you know how important it is for us to realize that and to take comfort in that promise of our God? It is because of this. You have an enemy, and the enemy is not flesh and blood. Your arch enemy is Satan himself, the liar, the great accuser, who is not human. He is superhuman. And he will not stop accusing us. He will not stop opposing us until Jesus takes us home to heaven. There's a verse in the book of Revelation that says the great accuser accuses our brothers and sisters, day and night. He doesn't take a break. And the amazing thing is, with all the things that he prosecutes us and puts against our account, we can say, yeah, some of those things might be true. What did we just confess today? We confess things that the devil would love to accuse us of. By nature, I am sinful and unclean. Even before I breathed my first infant breath, we were sinners through and through. We have strayed away from our God. We have offended our God. We deserve accusation. And then we deserve, as we confess, we deserve eternal death. The devil will not stop accusing us until he has brought more and more people with him to the eternal fires of hell. So how can my heart be still? My heart can only be still because against that prosecuting attorney, the devil, is my defense attorney, Jesus. Against all the devil's convictions against me, against all his lies, Jesus comes with facts. Did you hear about those facts as Paul puts them before us? He says four facts about Jesus. Jesus Christ died. And when Jesus died, he shed his blood for you so that all of your sins are forgiven. More than that, Paul says. Number two, Jesus not only died, he rose again. If Jesus were still in the grave, you're still in your sins. Your faith is futile. But Jesus arose, and that's your assurance that your sins are also forgiven. Number three, Jesus also ascended in power to the right hand of God Almighty. Jesus is there in power, ruling over all things for the good of his church. Did you just read those words in Romans 8:28? They're words that comfort me time and time again against the devil's assaults. In all things, God is working for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. I don't belong to the devil, neither do you. You belong to God. You are dearly beloved. You are purchased by him. And he is now in power and authority, in all reverence and honor in heaven. And what is he doing there in heaven? He's pleading your case. He is interceding for you. Jesus is your defense attorney. 1 John tells us that if we have sinned, we have one who speaks to the Father on our behalf. will usher you and invite you into the eternal kingdom, where you will be in all glory with him one day. These are the facts, dear friends. Trust those facts rather than trusting the great accusations of the devil. We come to the Lord confessing our sins, and then we also trust in his redeeming grace, which is the only thing that we cling to for help and hope now and for eternity to come. But some of you may think, well, how can I be sure of this? How can I be sure that these facts are true for me? How do I know that God is going to help me not only today, but the next day and the next day? Because there's going to be many more fires, many more trials that come into my life. God says, I prove my love for you. Here's another beautiful verse of comfort for you and for me. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? God had a dear treasure. The last thing he wanted to do was to do something to his dear treasure, his own son. It was this dear son who in the Garden of Gethsemane, we are told, cried out with loud cries to God, God, find another way. If it be possible, find another way to save these people. And you know what God the Father said? God the Father said, there is no other way. Go, my son. Go to the cross and there give your life on behalf of sinners. And that's what God did. If God did not spare his own son, but gave him up for you, he will also take care of all the other things in your life. He's on your side. He gave you Jesus. Trust in him. Find confidence in him each and every day of your life. He is your help. He is your guide. He is your defense lawyer. He will be there for you all the way. Well, you know that God will not listen to the devil's lies. He's covered his ears to them. He knows the truth that his son did complete the task. But the devil will try something else. If God will not listen to my lies, the devil will do something else. He will do this. He will take your sufferings, and he will begin to whisper in your ear. And he will tell you, look at how bad you are suffering. If you are suffering this badly, can you really be sure that God loves you and that God forgives you? All the while, the devil wants to do more than just create doubts in your mind. God wants to create a wedge between you and your God, so you are disconnected from your God. He will use those sufferings to disconnect you from your Savior. And if he can do that, he's won. God won't listen to the devil's accusations, but maybe you will listen to the devil creating doubts in your mind. What does God do when he tries, when the devil tries to create so many doubts in your mind? God will tell us that in the midst of all those troubles, he will be there to take care of you and to love you and build conviction in your heart concerning the love of God. Paul says it this way, shall trouble or hardship overcome you? Those words in the Greek really mean that there are pressures that press down from above upon you. They're coming down upon you. The hardships refer to pressures that come from the sides. When I think of these words that Paul writes, I'm thinking about those car crushers. There's the pancake crushers that come straight down, but there are others called baler crushers that crush from the sides and the top and bottom. That's the kind of pressure that's being described here. Have you ever experienced thinking that God has forgotten about you, God wants you to remember that you are more than conquerors through him who loved us. That means the victory is already yours. That's how much God loves you. God predestined you. That means God chose you before the creation of the world, before day number one, when he said, "Let there be light," he already knew you and loved you. Profound, isn't it? Isn't that a reason to trust God is there for us so that the Satan does not drive a wedge between us and our God? And since he predestined us, he also called us. He called you to be his own through the water and the word of holy baptism. He's clothed you in a robe of Christ's righteousness. Remember that call. And those he called, he also justified. Even though the devil accuses you and says you're guilty, God looks at you and says, "Through my son Jesus, you are innocent. You are mine." And those he justified, he also glorified. That glory is coming, but the glory is already yours. It's already as good as done, because heaven is sealed for you. And therefore, do you believe, as Paul was convinced, that there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God? As you leave here today, I cannot guarantee that you won't have any trouble in your life. In fact, I can guarantee the very opposite. God says that too. As God's child, you will face suffering. You will face persecution. We may one day face what else? Paul faced nakedness, or the dangers that lurk, or the sword. But Paul says, "Don't worry, be still my soul, because God still loves you. The victory is yours. You are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus who loved you." So if death comes, we're still victorious. If life comes with more sufferings, the Lord is still with us. If there are demons who attempt to attack us, Paul says, "What fear you have, stand upon the Lord and his word." If there are dark powers of this earth, rulers who would rather see us brought in hell rather than care for us, stand upon the Lord. Maybe there are troubles in your present. Maybe there will be troubles in your future. Continue to see past the suffering and look to the cross, where Jesus has won the victory for you. Wherever someone may take us, wherever that dark place may be, whether it's in the heights or the depths, it doesn't matter. Even if I go up, you are there with me, O Lord, or go down, you promise to be with me. That's God's great comfort to you. Trust him, dear friends. Trust him. Have the same confidence that Paul has. How will you have that same undying, unflinching confidence? It is because you remain close to the Lord through his word and sacrament. That is where God promises to be with you. And he not only promises to maintain your faith, he promises to deepen and even strengthen that faith in him. Who knows what troubles will come your way? Whatever they are, be still my soul. Why? The Lord is on your side. And with confidence, grace received this past hour through your word may bring forth fruits of piety and godliness in our relations with others in the home, in school, in the office, in the shop, at the store, and on the playground. Let it be effective in our business as well as in our social relationships. Govern all that we say and do to others by the love which your own love inspires in our hearts. We pray for our brothers and sisters, Tom Bloodgood, Patricia Cade, for Becky Copenhaver. We pray for all of these brothers and sisters of ours who continue to deal with crosses and trouble. We pray that you would uplift them and grant healing, recovery, and help in their time of need. We ask your blessing upon Nancy McCauley, who underwent a procedure on Thursday. Opening physician, bless her with great faith that you continue to uplift and strengthen her. We give you great thanks and praise for the recovery you are now granting to Richard Freebus following his successful surgery this past week. Continue to bless him in his time of need. We pray for Marilyn Roach undergoing cancer treatments. May who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Would you like to sing the final hymn? So if you would give some consideration to what your schedule is like, and then tell me what location you would feel most comfortable meeting with me. It can be you personally, it can be you and your extended family, whoever you would like with you.